shall wear a crown. I shall see his face. I shall see his face when this story, how I made it over. I'm going to put on my robe and tell the story. My room, no more crying there. Tell the story how I made it over. Of Jesus, when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all, when we see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We will sing. We will sing. We will shout. Shout our troubles over. We'll sing. We'll sing, oh, we will sing and shout the victory.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that I am there and you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except me. Do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroy. And where their treasure is, there your heart will be also. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at the last day on earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God, whom I see for myself. My eyes shall behold and not another. How my heart yearns within me. We brought nothing into this world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. This morning we've come to give the Lord glory, honor, and praise as we celebrate the life, and yes, even at such a young age, the legacy of our beloved son, our beloved brother, our beloved cousin, our beloved friend, our beloved drum major, Brother Kyle James Johnson, gone too soon, but his life has left a lifetime of blessings. And both as a family and a church family, our faith and trust in God will be the strength that we can boldly declare this morning. It is well, it is well, it is well with my soul. Brother Michael White and the ministers come now to lead us in worship. It is well. It is well. It is well. Precious Lord, take our hands. Lead us, Lord, and help us stand. Lord, at this hour, we ask by the power of thy Holy Spirit that your ministering angels will just continue, oh God, to touch our beloved sister. Lord, wrap your angels around Sister Denise Johnson this morning in a special way. Lord, minister to her heart, oh God, for a mother's heart is heavy. But oh God, we thank you. We thank you for the joy of mothering. We thank you, oh God, that you have blessed her, oh God, all these years to have been a witness and to pour into the life of this, her beloved son. God, we're praying for you to just continue to watch over and keep her and to strengthen her, oh God, and to be a witness, oh God, that she might be able to understand more fully by and by, that endure, that while weeping may endure for a night, that indeed joy comes in the morning, that the joy of the Lord shall indeed be her strength, oh God. So, Lord, where she cannot lift her hands at this hour, we're praying, oh God. We are interceding as a church family, oh God, and we're lifting up hands, oh God, to give you honor and glory and praise, God. Where we can't see you, oh God, we as a church family will trace you for her, God, to show her our love and to show forth, oh God, your outpouring of your spirit upon this family. Touch Brother Kevin, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Pour out your spirit upon this brother, oh God, today in a mighty way, God. Let him know that you reign supreme, oh God. Cover, oh God, this family, and as only you can do. Be a comfort, oh God. Be a hedge of protection around them, oh God. We just come today to give your name honor. God, we're coming to give your name glory. We can boldly declare that we understand that we do not understand. But this morning we know that our God reigns, that you reign supreme, oh God, and your infinite wisdom. We ask by the power of your Holy Spirit that you would just touch, that you would comfort, that you would be, oh God, in the midnight hour, that which they need, oh God, to remember that you are in complete control. Pour out your spirit, and when this day is said and done, we, your people, will give you the honor. Lord, we're going to give you the glory. Lord, we're going to give you the praise, because it's in Jesus' name that we come. And let all who believe say amen, amen. And bless God. Praise the Lord this morning as we come now to be led in our reading of the scripture by Reverend Julie Crump, who comes to read our Old Testament scripture found in the book of Psalms, the 23rd division of the Psalms, and the New Testament reading coming from 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. Immediately following after our reading of our scripture, Sister Dana Kelly, Kyle's godmother, comes with a special musical selection, A Secret Place. Hear them now and be blessed.
Praise God. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness, for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Verses 13 through 18. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will be by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise. Then we who are alive will remain and shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. God's word for God's people.
Blessings and so many open doors, a brand new mercy. That's why I praise you, and for this I give you praise.
And if there is any question or any wondering of that secret place, I had the joy and the pleasure of joining the Johnson's family and Kyle's classmates, both from Gaithersburg High School and Towson University, for the memorial celebration that they had for him. And that gave us an opportunity to get a glimpse into just who this young man was. Sister Denise, the next day, sent me a picture that she had received from one of Kyle's friends of a rainbow that had formed in the sky at the conclusion of the memorial service. And for those of you who are out there who are very clear, there was not a drop of rain that had fallen in the sky. It was hot and sunny, but yet there was this rainbow in the sky. And that was just, I believe, the Lord telling us, letting us know that Kyle was in the secret place, that he was there, and you need not worry. Those of you who came to celebrate them, they sent that word that morning. And we were grateful for having been there that evening. Your reflections were a blessing, I'm sure, to the entire family. And this morning, we come right now for those who the family have just asked to share for a few more reflections, that each of you will have 2 minutes to come. As you come, please come to my left here to the podium, as you are called, and allow an opportunity for in between your moment and reflection to allow Brother Nathan to come and to clean that mic between each speaker. And so I will call you in this order that we, Brother Pedro Pena, who I understand is a close friend and roommate of Brother Kyle and Brother Jim Nymoler, please forgive me for that, Nymoler. And then finally we'll hear from Kyle's older brother, Brother Kevin Johnson, will come. If you would come in that order, let's hear now those words of reflections. Brother Pedro.
Good morning, everyone. I would just like to share a few words. First and foremost, I would just like to extend my love and appreciation to the Johnson family. You opened the doors of your home to me, and I'll forever appreciate it. Excuse me. It's kind of crazy, actually, relating to the rainbow that occurred during the vigil. I have a short story, but not too long ago, I was doing a class at the University of Maryland, and I'm not gonna get into the details of it, but it's like a military-related class, and it's for the honor guard. It's kind of almost poetic in a way that, you know, it's to honor fallen service members, but I began the class, Kyle's there, you know, he used to always crack jokes because I'm shining my shoes, and he's like, man, what are you doing? And I'm just, but you know, he never was anything negative. It was like, I hope you get it. And it's weird, actually, one of the last few words I had with him was, I hope you have a good class today. And during the final, which was this past Friday, you know, I'm there, it's hot out, and the way it works is the American flag is the commander, and it was my turn to do the commanding for the first football guard of the final. And as I'm about to, it's called a detail to fall in the very back, you know, you may call it a coincidence, call it what you are, but, you know, I hear in the back just drumline cadence. And I was just there, you know, I almost didn't want to shed a tear or anything, but I just kind of smiled and was like, man, you know, I had no words for it. I was just kind of like, he's there, he got me. And from there, you know, went on past the final and everything went well. But with that being said, I would just like to not, you know, tell anyone, but I just suggest and propose the idea that, you know, although Kyle is not with us at this moment, walking the earth with us anymore, I ask that we all look in our lives to find ways to see that, you know, he still is there. He's still, you know, we're holding it down for him down here, and he's holding it down for us up there. And he'll keep finding ways to, you know, interject his love and care, whether it be music, whether it be, you know, that freaking drumline cadence, all types of things. But, you know, I would just like to suggest that to everyone because it's really helped me deal with everything that's going on. And it, you know, it's kind of like the icing on the cake to, you know, I still got you, bro. And I know he still has every one of us here. So thank you.
Morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Jim Niemoller. I'm a longtime family friend of the Johnson family. I'm also the head coordinator of our Appalachia Service Project team at Mill Creek Parish United Methodist Church. After Kevin Sr.'s passing and conversation with Kevin Jr. and Kyle, they joined us on our Appalachia Service Project trips to honor their father, and I can't think of a more beautiful thing they could have done for that. Kyle loved people. It was evident Saturday before last at Gaithersburg High School. It was evident at his time serving at Appalachia Service Project. It was evident to everyone that came into his life. Kyle loved people. Appalachia Service Project was started in 1969 by a Methodist minister who felt young people, high school and college people, could make a real tangible difference in the world by serving to help repair homes of impoverished families in deep Appalachia, making them warmer, safer, and drier. And in 2015, the first year Kyle joined us, 15,000 other volunteers did as well. And the work is amazing. Each year, Appalachia Service Project has a theme scripture for the work we're doing. And I want to share the theme scripture from 2016. The theme was handiwork, created to serve. And the scripture was Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God has prepared beforehand for us to be our way of life. Kyle lived these words. Sometimes overtly, sometimes subtly, but the way he loved and embraced everyone, it was apparent he was living the life God had chosen for him. In 2016, the evening before we departed for Appalachia Service Project, I received a personal phone call from the CEO and president of the organization asking us to reroute to Raynell, West Virginia, which less than 48 hours before had suffered a 1,000-year devastating flood, destroying and decimating the town. To me, it was a no-brainer. We were going to Raynell. We were going to help. That week, we saw families that with their lives turned upside down, homes flooded in muddy water, every worldly possession destroyed. All they had was themselves. One particular moment that comes to mind, the first Monday of that week. We're riding around in the truck, my work team. We see a couple in their 70s looking absolutely defeated, trying to muck mud and wet furniture out of their home. We stopped and asked, can we give you guys a hand? They said, absolutely. For the next several hours, we sat down, talked with them, listened, gave them a shoulder to cry on, helped them sort through damaged goods, papers, family memorabilia, moved furniture out of their house, and just loved and embraced complete strangers we'd never seen before. End of that afternoon, none of us wanted to leave because there was a special bond there that they will always remember, and I know all of us, including Kyle, would always remember. I had an opportunity 3 months later to go back and visit this same couple. And their words to me were, "You guys really saved us. We didn't know how we were gonna get through this, but you and your team of young people that came to help, asking nothing in favor, energized a spark in us, and we said, we know we're gonna be okay." Kyle loved people everywhere he went. And there's nothing that we can do to better honor Kyle than let a little bit of that love radiate through us as well. Let's help someone.
It's with love that I come in front of all you. Anybody that's known me or known of me for the last couple years, it's always love. I would like to first thank everyone that played a part in Kyle's life, whether it be small or big, whether it be minute or huge. He held a special part in everyone's heart that he ever touched, so I just want to first say thank you to everyone that played a positive part in his life. I could tell many a stories. But I just like to share with everyone I found solace in the known fact that God doesn't make any mistakes. And while a lot of things we won't or can't understand here, or won't ever have the time to, still with God's grace, we still have faith and we still move forward. Again, I could not gonna tell too many stories, but I wanna lighten up a little bit. I had a dream as a 14-year-old kid that I was gonna make it to the NBA. I would have Kyle playing me outside one-on-one to 100 till he didn't want to play anymore. Kyle was my best friend a lot of times, and he'll be greatly missed, but thank you all.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for those words and for the gift and for sharing your love with us this morning. At this time, I just want to say Sister Denise and Brother Kevin are grateful. I'm speaking on behalf, one Johnson speaking for another. I'm grateful for the outpouring of love and support that they have received from all of you gathered here today, and for those of you who are joining virtually. Words cannot express how much your cards and your calls have meant to them. But this morning, the family has asked us to just read a few of those words of expressions, as well as we will read those acknowledgments and resolutions. So the Reverend Renee Jones comes now with acknowledgments and resolutions, followed by the church letter, which will be then immediately followed by the reading of the obituary by Reverend Tyrone Scott, cousin of Kyle's.
Good morning. Thank you for this honor, Sister Denise. I was one of Kyle's Sunday school teachers. So, Mrs. Johnson and Kevin, Kyle was my closest friend. Wherever I needed someone or whenever I needed someone to talk to, Kyle was there for me. He was talented, smart, charismatic, and well-liked by everyone. People like him because people like him don't come around very often, which is why I'm so grateful that he was a part of my life. Kyle will forever be in my thoughts. I'm deeply sorry for your loss. With love, Tyler Honor. Love goes on forever. May the love that surrounds you bring you strength and comfort now and in the days ahead. Much love to you and your family, Billy. Thinking of you. You have lost someone very special, someone who touched many hearts. And those hearts will touch many more. And in that way, your loved one will always remain a part of you, a part of everything. With sincere sympathy, love, Precious, Sydney, and Elijah. Appalachian Service Project. Resolution in honor of Kyle James Johnson. Whereas Kyle James Johnson understood the importance of serving others in a world where many lie in poverty, both economically and relationally, and whereas by serving, Kyle helped change the world, one family at a time. And whereas Kyle served faithfully as a volunteer in three different states, Virginia, West Virginia, and Kentucky, by showing love and care to those in need. And whereas Kyle showed compassion on families suffering tragedy by performing flood relief immediately after the 2016 year flood in Raynell, West Virginia. And whereas Kyle served faithfully through Mill Creek United Methodist Church with Appalachia Service Project during three summers to assist ASP in fulfilling our mission of making the homes of low-income families in Central Appalachia warmer, safer, and drier. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the board, the president and CEO, and the staff of the Appalachia Service Project honors and recognizes Kyle for his dedication and contributions to our mission and thanks his family for sharing his vision and passion with us during his all too short time among us. Be it further resolved that the facility used by ASP next summer, where Mill Creek United Methodist Church performs its week of service, shall be called the Kyle James Johnson Center for the duration of ASP's 2022 summer program. Approved this 25th day, August, in the year of our Lord, 2021, by the Reverend Dr. Walter Crouch, President and CEO, Appalachia Service Project. On August 18th, 2021, Kyle Johnson gave the sacred gift of life through the selfless act of organ and tissue donation. The gift of Kyle's liver saved a 65-year-old female. The gift of Kyle's right kidney saved a 16-year-old female. The gift of Kyle's left kidney saved a 59-year-old male. The gift of Kyle's heart saved a 49-year-old male. Through the life-enhancing gift of tissue donation, Kyle has the potential to impact the lives of two other recipients. His corneas, when transplanted, will restore sight to these two individuals.
Kyle will forever be remembered as a hero to many, as his donor medal states, to serve a single life is to save an entire world. Indeed, Kyle's gift has changed the world. The Living Legacy Foundation of Maryland, on behalf of all of those awaiting a life-saving transplant, would like to thank the Johnson family for their patience and courage. Their kindness and compassion are what enable the thousands of people awaiting a transplant to maintain hope. Their unwavering support and a lasting testament to Kyle and their immense fortitude and inner strength during such a difficult time. Scotland AME Zion Church Resolution of Respect for Kyle Johnson. We, the members of the Scotland AME African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, share in the remembrance of Kyle Johnson. Though his days among us were too brief and our grief at his loss is never ending, we draw comfort from the knowledge that he has found safe refuge in the Lord and in our hearts. We bless his remembrance with our love and our blessings. Whereas Kyle Johnson received his early faith foundation as a former member and Sunday school student at the Scotland African Episcopal Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, suddenly passed from this life on Sunday, August 8th, 2021. And whereas Kyle Johnson participated in the Varitz Children VCYC and was active in the youth ministry and other related activities. Whereas Kyle Johnson grew in his faith outside of Scotland with the Kingdom Fellowship AME Church and spent his summers during college in the Appalachian Mountain areas of West Virginia and Kentucky, repairing and building the homes of the underprivileged residents. Whereas Kyle Johnson ministered in music to us in the church, in his former high school bands, and for many others. And whereas Kyle Johnson was a young leader who touched the lives of many young people and who was loved by many more. Therefore, be it resolved that the Scotland AME Zion Church will preserve and cherish the memory of Kyle and increase our efforts to conduct outreach to youth and young adults. The Scotland African Methodist Episcopal Church of Potomac, Maryland, offers its sincerest condolences to the family of Kyle Johnson, and we salute his easygoing demeanor by one of his favorite expressions, "Let it be." Kingdom Fellowship AME Church. Dear Sister Denise Johnson and family, on behalf of the Kingdom Fellowship African Methodist Episcopal Church, we were extremely sorry to hear of the passing of your son, brother, and friend, Kyle Johnson. We extend our deepest sympathy and condolences to you and your family during this time of bereavement. We realize there is a great emptiness left by Brother Kyle's passing, and that he will be greatly missed by you, the family and friends who knew and loved him. No words can lessen the pain that comes with your loss, but we find hope in Jesus' words as recorded in the Gospel of John. "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." John chapter 11, verses 25 and 26. Yes, our hope resides in the promises of the Lord that we have everlasting life in him. My prayer is with you and that our God, who is the God of all comfort, will grant freely and fully the measure of grace that gives us strength in weakness and despair. Please don't hesitate to let us know if we can be of service to you. May God's richest blessings be with you. in Christ, Reverend Matthew L. Whatley, Senior Pastor.
Praise the Lord, everyone. To my family, I extend my sincere condolences. Just want you to remember one word. It's actually a name, and it's Yemima. This is the name of Job's daughter after Job had suffered much loss, and the name simply means day by day. We're going to get better day by day. It's my privilege and my honor to read Kyle's obituary. Kyle James Johnson was born January 26, 2000, in Silver Spring, Maryland, to the late Kevin Van Johnson Sr. and Denise Jackson Johnson. He departed this life on Sunday, August 15, 2021, at Sinai Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland. Kyle attended Goshen Elementary School, Forest Oak Middle School, and graduated from Gaithersburg High School in the class of 2018. He was a rising senior at Towson University, majoring in electronic media and film at the time of his passing. Kyle was an honor roll student and an athlete. He played football for Clarksburg and South Germantown and basketball for Forest Oak Middle School and I-270 in Gaithersburg, Maryland. It was his love for music that was his passion. It began at the early age of 2 years old at Scotland AME Zion Church while watching the musician play each week. Amen. He would use pencils, pens, or straws to follow the drummer on each selection. Kyle went on to play drums in the Goshen Elementary School Band, the Forest Oak Middle School Jazz Band, and then the Gaithersburg High School Marching Band, Jazz Band, and School Musical Band. While at Gaithersburg High School, he was elevated to drumline captain and created a medley that is still being used by the band today. His music taste was as electric as his friendship. His playlist included Johnny Guitar Watson, Uncle Cracker, Young Thug, Cardi B, Maroon 5, the Doobie Brothers, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Chuck Brown, and everything in between. But favorite amongst favorites were John Mayer and Snarky Puppy. To know Kyle is to know Snarky Puppy. Kyle was the recipient of several awards while at Gaithersburg High School. Louis Armstrong Jazz Award, Outstanding Service Award for Band, Certificate of Recognition for School Musical Participation, and Montgomery County Public School Jazz Soloist Competition winner for 2018. Besides music, he loved being on the water, going out for long drives in his beloved Red, Colorado, playing basketball, and riding his motorcycle. He was giving and caring towards everyone he met. He loved his family, and his closest friend, mentor, and father figure was his brother, Kevin. He often said that Kevin stepped up to be the father that he had lost, and he appreciated Kevin more than he had the chance to say. He adored his sister, Lauren, and wanted to see her fully healed of cancer. Her suffering broke his heart, He was still a baby to his mom, and much to Kevin and Lauren's annoyance, she still treated him like so. Kyle loved Kobe, and he was hurt by Kobe's passing, especially since it was on his birthday. His favorite sports teams were the LA Lakers and Pittsburgh Steelers. He only wanted to live life to the fullest each day and was proud to help others. For 3 years, Kyle volunteered alongside his brother Kevin with the Appalachian Service Project mission, trips to rural Appalachia to repair homes for the underprivileged families. Kyle never had a harsh word for anyone and was rarely angered by anything. He lived his mantra of "let it be," and it was one of his many tattoos. Kyle was raised in the church and accepted Christ as his savior as a teenager. He attended Scotland AME Zion Church and later became a member of Reed Temple AME Church and then Kingdom Fellowship AME Church. Kyle leaves to cherish his memory, his loving mother Denise, sister Lauren, brother Kevin Jr., Luli, grandmother Marianne Jacobs, great aunt Rosemarie Bullitt, great uncles Benjamin Jackson, Thomas Jackson, Ivy, Clyde Jackson, Kathy, Robert Jackson, Pam, aunts Carolyn Gray Everett, Tina Cunningham, Terry Hines, Deidre Jacobs, Cecilia Bell George, Daphne Diddle, uncles Clifton Ng, John Cunningham, Alan Dove, Karen, Mitchell Dove, Shonda, nephews Xavier and Zaire Noel, godparents Dana Kelly, Aaron Wilson, Terrence and Lisa Hall, lifelong friends Jack Metcalf, Hunter Cleaver, Pedro Pina, and Antonio Negron, and his beloved pet, Kobe Bean, along with a host of other family and friends. Kyle was preceded in death by his father, Kevin Van Johnson Sr., grandparents Clifton and Marjorie Johnson, Alan Dove, and Johnny Jacobs, godfather Gavin Hines, and cousin Jessica Stevenson Ashley. This is the reading of Kyle's obituary.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend Stott. Come on, we can give God praise for a life well lived. 21 years, but in his 21 years, he accomplished a great deal, more than some that we might know. And we're truly grateful for the blessing that God has been. And this week, as our hearts continue to be heavy, Kyle's ultimate dream and desire was for his big sister to be fully healed. And she was fully healed as he met her as she entered into heaven right alongside him. Our hearts are heavy, but we find comfort in knowing that God is indeed in control. And so at this time, as we prepare now for the word that shall come from our senior pastor, the Reverend Matthew L. Whatley, prepare your hearts after the singing of the sermonic selection. The voice that you will hear will be that of our pastor. Pray for him as he comes.
I can only imagine what it would be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes would see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine to be surrounded by your glory. What will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah, yeah, Lord. I can only imagine, yes, oh Lord, to be surrounded by your glory. What will my heart feel? Will I dance in your presence? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Or will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah.
With the exception of the family, would you stand? If you don't mind, lift your hands. Father, nothing in our hands do we bring. Only to your cross do we claim. We stand before you now empty, hurting, confused, angry. We stand before you as vacant vessels before a full fountain. And so, God, we pray that you might pour into each of us that which we need to move forward in the wake of the loss of Brother Kyle. And even with all of the emotion that swirls within us, for those of us who know you, even in this moment of grief, we grieve, but not as those who have no hope. For God, even now, you still have the words of eternal life. So speak right now. Your servants are listening. It's in Jesus' name we want to say thank you. And all God's children said, amen. So we continue to stand. The word of God speaks to us today from Ecclesiastes, the 9th chapter, beginning reading at the 10th verse. Ecclesiastes, the 9th chapter, beginning reading at the 10th verse, and there these words are recorded. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with your might, for there is no work or device or knowledge or wisdom in the grave where you are going. I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to men of understanding, nor favor to men of skill, but time and chance happen to them all. For man also does not know his time, like fish taken in a cruel net, like birds caught in a snare. So the sons of men are snared in an evil time when it falls suddenly upon them. Thus far the word of God. As the Spirit does speak and God does God, we just want to use as a sermonic subject, let it be. God bless you. You may take your seats in the presence of the Lord. To Sister Denise and Kevin and the family, I'll share with the congregation what I shared with you on the phone. I don't have any words, but we thank God, God does speak. So ask for an answer to your prayers as we use this as a subject, let it be. Let me start off by just dispelling three myths that we commonly hear in times of great loss. First thing that we have to get over is something we've heard a lot. If you do good, good will come to you. That ain't true. And oftentimes we say stuff and put God's name in stuff that God never said. When you read the Bible, which is the Word of God, you'll discover that the Bible is a book of faith in the wake of tragedy. Read your Bible. You can't get to chapter number 4 in Genesis before murder and loss happen and parents grieve their child. You can be innocent like Kyle and tragedy still come to you. The Bible tells us, even though when you read it, Genesis comes first, the oldest book is actually the book of Job. And the Bible in Job 1 describes him this way. He was a man who was upright more than any other person in the land. And yet as his children gathered in the house, a windstorm came and he lost them. Did I tell you, you can do good and good still not come to you? Jesus, the Bible tells us, was in all ways tempted, but knew no sin. He was perfect. And yet, that cross is a living reminder that innocence is no protection from tragedy. I need us to hear that because the adversary is real and will try to whisper in our ears, there's some reason, this ain't no reason to justify this kind of tragedy. Because innocence, even innocence, can't protect us from this thing called life. First myth I wanted to dispel is that if you do good, good comes to you. Secondly, and this is one you hear a lot in church, that if you have faith, you shouldn't question God. Show me the page in the Word where it says you can't question God. And I will show you on every page how the people of God question God. In fact, you know, Israel, Jacob, who became Israel, Israel that became the name of the nation of the children of God. His name actually means the one who wrestles with man and with God and survives. Not only does God allow questions, God expects questions. In fact, God came with questions. Read your Bible, you'll discover that Jesus raised over 300 questions and only directly answered three. My point is that you don't have to apologize for the questions you have, because I ain't apologizing for mine. There's nobody in here of good sense that has not had to wrestle with how, God, can you allow, if you're supposed to be good, supposed to have all power, then how can you allow such tragedy to happen to him and to them? And all I would remind you is, if you have enough courage and strength to ask questions, don't just ask and hang up the phone, but hang around long enough for God to deal with your question and to, more importantly, deal with you. Myth number one, do good, good will good come to you. If you, myth number two, you can't ask God any questions. And three, if there's any question we think we could ask, it's this question: why? And if we had to boil it down, that's it. This is the question that I was led to actually record a video about on the passing of Kobe Bryant on Kyle's birthday. We all were feeling like we feel now when we got news about how he and his daughter and the rest of the team went down in that helicopter. And I did the video, you can check it out on YouTube, because I wanted people to understand that as believers, God has a whole category to help us wrestle with this. It's called theodicy, T-H-E-O-D-I-C-Y, theodicy. And it basically tries to help us to understand how bad things can happen to good people and how we can claim God to be good when it seems like he's allowed bad to happen to his people. And it all comes down to that same question: why? I'll share with you what I shared on that video. It actually was based on the same scripture that when I was a younger man and my daughter was much younger, remember, she asked me the question, Daddy, why is the sky blue? Now, Daddy been to school. Daddy figured this was a great opportunity to show her why education is so important. So I said, well, you know, baby, the reason the sky is blue is because when the sunlight hits the Earth's surface, the Earth shatters the sunlight into the various colors of the spectrum. And the shortest wavelength of all the colors of the spectrum belongs to the color blue. That's why it appears as if the sky is blue. Very satisfied that I had provided her a very scientific and logical answer, she said to me, "Okay, Daddy, but why?" Recognizing I'd overshot the runway, I figured I'd come at it as the man of God. I said, "Well, baby, the sky is blue because that's the God color God wanted to make it." I'm like, "That's got to do it." She said, "Yeah, Daddy, but why?" And that's when I realized that the difficulty with the question why, you have the right to ask it. And don't you let anybody take that away from you. But you need to know that why is a road that never returns home. Because as soon as you come up with an answer, why will come up at another why. And so rather than us trying to get our minds around the irrational, that which cannot be justified or given any reasoning, I want to suggest to us that we find comfort in three simple messages we find in this text. First of all, we understand, according to this text, that we are to live life like Kyle with all our might. Hear the word of the Lord. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with your might. For there is no work or device or knowledge or wisdom in the grave where you are going. If you knew Kyle, you knew he lived his life to the fullest. He found time to love the Lord. He found time to love his family and friends. He found time to laugh a lot. He found time to live his best life, to ride his mic, to drive his car, to listen to his music, to conduct and to create music, to do his thing. He lived life with all his might. And as Reverend Johnson said earlier, there are persons that are 81 that have not lived the amount of life he lived at 21. It's a crazy concept, but if you recall, that the first rocket that made its way to outer space that was manned by humans had less computing power than what's held in my cell phone. My cell phone, my smartphone right now is more powerful than the rocket that brought somebody to space. You can have a lot of power in a small space. And Kyle's life is a testament to what you can do if you allow God to show you how to live life with all your might. And I would remind you, I said the first rocket, because now those rockets have a whole bunch more computing power. And they're able to take from one stage to another, to the heavens, where Kyle and Lauren now wait. First thing we learn is to live life with all our might. Secondarily, we learn that life is a, as the Bible says, a vapor. Life is a vapor. That we are not guaranteed. We don't know from day to day when our time is up. Here's how the scripture puts it, and I want you to hear it because, again, you've heard something that's not in scripture. The race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong. And what do we say? But the one that endures to the end. That sounds good, because it sounds like you can get what you deserve, but we already showed that ain't the truth. Here's what the Bible says. The race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to men of understanding, nor favor to men of skill, but time and chance happen to them all. That at the end of the day, even when I love God and I serve God, I still am prone to life. You heard that opening hymn. And for those of you who don't know him, it may have sound kind of strange. How can they be singing, it is well with it? Isn't that a little insensitive? Couldn't they come up with another song? Well, you got to know the words. You got to know the one we're singing to, and you got to know the one who wrote it. Horatio Gates Stafford, many of you all know, had planned to go with his family from Chicago to London, England, to hear Dwight L. Moody, their pastor, preached there. Spafford had to stay back to take care of some business, sent his wife and his daughters on. They were crossing the Atlantic when their ship ran into another ship, and in 12 minutes, all of them perished except his wife. And upon then him boarding the ship and sailing over those same waters, and the captain of that ship pointing out the place where the prior ship had gone down, he then resolved himself to write those words: when peace like a river attends my way, when sorrow like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. That you teach me to say things that are aspirational so that I might attain them. That I sing, it is well, even when it's not well, in order that it might be well. In other words, at some point, we have to just let it be. And rather than twisting ourselves and not and trying to figure out stuff that's beyond our pay grade, we would do better to simply give ourselves over to God and to allow God, the God of all comfort, to bring healing in his time and in his way. Finally, that's the last thing we learn from the life of Kyle and from this text, that we ought to live our lives for the Lord. Kyle knew the Lord. Kyle loved the Lord. And because of that, we don't have to wonder or worry where he is. The text is tailored to teach us that even in our love for God, one more time, life will happen. It says, for man also does not know his time, like fish taken in a cruel net, like birds caught in a snare. So the sons of men are snared in an evil time when it falls suddenly upon them. And I hear you. I hear you. Saying, well, Reverend, if I'm supposed to love the Lord, what's the point if I still can fall victim to life? And the answer is this: my faith relationship with God does not protect and prevent tragedy and trouble from showing up. The point of insurance doesn't, the fact that I have insurance doesn't keep my house from falling down, from burning down. The point of insurance is to have the assurance that if the worst happens, I can recover and I will be restored. So I want to encourage you today. I don't have any words. God does. Let it be. I didn't know he liked snarky puppy like me. I'm going to have to listen. But I do want to leave you with this. That Kyle's life provides our lives the opportunity to live our best life. Young people, y'all don't know. Today is here to tell you that tomorrow's not promised. The stuff you hear old people say is because we've lived enough to see more of life than you. It's not that we're smarter, we just seen more. We want you to know that Kyle's life is a witness that if you live right, you can die right. To live means to die. That's why we're called mortal. But if you live right, you can die right. I said you can die right. Boy used to travel on the way back from high school after football practice on the bus, city bus, to his house. He would get off the bus every day at this graveyard. And, you know, during the winter months in the evening, it was dark by the time he got off the bus. He never stuttered. He never stalled. He would get off the bus, run through the graveyard like he was running through the park at noontime. And a lady who was riding the bus after seeing this for several days, finally her curiosity got the best of her. Before he got to a stop, she couldn't help but ask, young man, I see you get off this bus every day with a smile on your face and you run in the graveyard at night in the dark as if you're running through a playground at noontime. How in the world do you do it? He said, to be honest with you, I don't like running through the graveyard and I don't like running through there at night. but my house is on the other side, and that's the only way I can get home. Just the other day, life pulled the string for Kyle Stott. He disembarked the bus, made his way through the graveyard, but I stand with good news that now he's home. I need thee. Oh, I need thee. Every hour, I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Brother Michael, if you would just minister that song, I want to provide the opportunity for somebody to get to know the God of Kyle Johnson. The God of Lauren Johnson. The God of Kevin Johnson Sr. and Kevin Johnson Jr. and Denise Johnson. The God of Horatio Spafford. The God of members that I see whose family members I've had to eulogize as well. We stand here today to let you know being a believer doesn't mean life won't happen. It just means when it happens, you don't have to handle it by yourself. Because we have a God that will meet our need. Come on, Michael. Jesus, at this hour we come to you. We pray that your peace that surpasses all understanding, that God, you can give us peace even when we don't understand. A peace that is unusual and unexplainable, an inner strength to soldier on. capacity to keep on keeping on. God, I pray that you might grant that to this family, to all of us, even in this hour. God, do in this moment what you've done in prior moments. And then, God, I pray for the moments and days and years to come, that you might continue to show up and be strong and be mighty and be present. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, brothers and sisters, the last thing I must do is to provide you the opportunity to get to know the God of Kyle Johnson, the God of this family that holds them even at this moment when they can't hold themselves. And so after the conclusion of this service, after we have recessed, after we've walked out the sanctuary, all these preachers with these funny looking robes up here are going to be available to you. Don't have to do anything in public. Don't have to come down like on TBN. All you have to do is come and share with them, I want to know that God for myself. They'd be happy to show you in the Word of God what it means to be saved. You know, you can know that there is a God and still not have a saving relationship with God. The devil knows there's a God, he ain't saved. You have to know him for yourself. So if you're here and you're unsaved or unsure what it means to be saved, one of our ministers would be happy to show you in the Word of God what salvation is all about and pray with you the prayer of salvation. If you're saved but you don't have a church home where you're growing and getting stronger, life is too hard for you to try to handle on your own, we'd be happy to have you here or to direct you to a place. We just want you to be covered so you can grow. So immediately following this service, just find one of the preachers in the robes and they'll hook you up with the Holy God. Let the church say amen. I'm going to ask now that the ministers would assemble themselves, and as well as those from the funeral home, as you prepare to recess. The interment will occur on next week after the homegoing celebration. So we're going to do the interment today, so we'll be following. So please follow the directions of the funeral home, who will help us to arrive that place that has been designated for the final resting earthly place of the remains of Brother Kyle, because we know that already his spirit is in his heavenly home. You all may come now. Let's prepare to be dismissed. I'm going to remind us that because of COVID requirements, that we are to do all that we can to maintain our social distance and to maintain face coverings. Good. Even my enemies came to eat of my flesh. They stumbled and fell. Though a host encamp about me, and this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his tabernacle, in his pavilion.
As God gives me grace,
God gives me grace,
I'll run this race,
I'll run this race,
until I see my Savior face to face.